I don't think, except for maybe the first day, to say that we weren't going to use it. And that is an IDE. What does IDE mean? What does the letters IDE stand for? And or what is it? I guess it doesn't really matter if you don't know what they stand for, if you know what it is. Yes?
The platform where you can design your application and it already has prefix stuff like stuff to build your GUI on and it's a lot easier to start an application from scratch.
Okay. It's a tool used to build applications is probably the simplest way to put it. Student mentioned to create an application, to create a GUI, and so on. And again, for example, the Microsoft world, the primary IDE would be Visual Studio. You can use that to create ASP.NET pages or desktop applications or whatever. We're going to look at a Java IDE, and there's a few IDEs for Java, and I just had to pick one, so I picked Eclipse. And Eclipse is installed on the machines upstairs. And what we're going to do is we're going to install it if it doesn't take too long. So I'm going to install it on this machine. If it takes too long, I have it on my laptop, and we'll just view it on my laptop, taking into account some subtle differences like I run a Mac, and the machines upstairs are Windows. You're welcome to install it. It's free. So let's do that. And then we'll look at some of the features for it, and we'll talk about what I want for the last lab. So let's go here. And let's Google install Eclipse. We can go here, and there's actually a lot of options that you have. Eclipse for a variety of different platforms. Excuse me. We're going to just take the basic one, Eclipse IDE for Java developers, and we'll download 64-bit application. It's thinking about it. And I can download it. Should just take a few more seconds. This sort of, if you will, sits on top of Java. So it's an IDE. It's a development tool that works with the Java that you already have installed on your machine. So extract everything to the desktop, let it do its thing. Yes? There will be a final, as is noted on the syllabus. It will probably be an online final, but we'll discuss that for sure. Okay. All right. So, there it is. It's actually just there's no install process, it just creates this, so probably would have been better to put it in program files, but I didn't. Let's double click it to get started here. The exe. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to import one of my examples into it, so we have something to look at. The biggest topic for this last week is, first of all, getting you a little bit familiar with a Java IDE, and then also talking about deployment methods. For example, you've written, you want to use Java on a project. How do you get that code into the hands of people? And we're using Eclipse. We're going to use Eclipse to do one of the methods. That is, we're going to create a jar file. JAR stands for Java Archive. All right. This is asking me where I want my workspace to be. All right, and I'm just going to put it in my user directory. My user here is LCCCLab, and the workspace is called Eclipse Workspace. Excuse me. So I'm going to launch that. And while it's thinking about that and getting started, I'm going to download from Canvas my most recent pizza example. Or not. All right, so let me go and download that. I think this is the most recent one. I'll download it. And I will extract it. Okay. So this is a startup window, and you have a number of different things. This is your configuration settings. Create a whole Hello World application. It will show you how to do that using Eclipse. Create a new Java project. That's what you would do if you're coming in from scratch. Check out a project from Git. Who is familiar with Git in this class? Can you explain what Git is? Okay. It's a portfolio or it's an archive of application code that you've developed that you can share with people. Yeah, you can use it as a portfolio. You could put applications that you've worked on and all that up there. What would you use, if you weren't going to use it for a portfolio, what would you use Git for? Exactly. To share code if it was a team effort. So, for example, if it was something that was being worked on, an open source project perhaps, or something that was worked on for a team of developers. And essentially it is a version control thing, so that, you know, with some code you don't want people overwriting code that is being worked on and so forth. So you can sort of check out a copy and make changes and then upload your changes to it. So that's something that's cool. That's something I wish we had more time, we probably would explore. Possibly I'll talk about it more next week. I'm not sure. What we're going to do is this. We're going to import an existing project. All right? And then there's tutorial samples and so on. At a marketplace. All right. I'm going to browse for this. And the root directory is going to be Where did I put it? I put it on the desktop. That directory. I could also, if I had an archive, a Java archive, I could bring that in. Different choices there, but I don't have a root directory. Actually, my mistake. This is not a project I'm importing. All right, I'm going to import my individual files. So I'm going to create a new project. That's my mistake. So I created a new project. Let's go back and repeat that. Because I want to do the piece that you're going to do in lab for your last lab assignment. All right, I'm going to menu's different. Java development, that's not what I want. All right, I'm just going to go and say I want a new Java project. All right. We get to give it a pizza, a name. So for this one, we're going to call it pizza. Where is it going to store it? It's going to store it in the default location, which is the workspace that we have defined. Use execution environment for the JRE. We're using Java SE 1.8. Create separate folders for sources and class files. All right, we're going to do that. And I'm going to click finish. So here we go. We're now in our pizza. I'm going to go and I'm going to import code from a variety of different places. I could import something that I've pulled from Git. I'm going to look in the file system for it. I get to pick the directory. That is pizza 12, pizza. I then get to pick what I want to import. Since I'm going to be building the executables and the classes and all that, I'm going to ignore the class files and just bring in the Java source files. And I get to choose what folder I want to bring it into. So I click finish, and that brings it into this application. And there you go. Actually, I probably should put this in source. So I'll move those over in there. So now they are in source and they're in the default package. One thing that you will see said throughout Java deployment and development is a package. A package is simply a set of things that you group together. All right? So you group things together for any number of reasons. If you imagine, imagine at LC, you know, there being, you know, some classes that are going to be common between many different applications. You would probably put them in a common package, and each application then could import that package and use the classes found therein. So you could have a different application for counseling and a different application still for financial services and academic services and so on and so forth. Well, there's going to be some classes that are going to span all those. So you would put classes like that, the common classes, in its own package That way you could deploy that when you deployed these other applications, and you'd put common code in a package, so you group things together. Packages are simply a way to group things together. Right now we have everything in the default package, but we could make more packages. A later example, either today or some other time, I'll go and I'll create a package to show you how we can do it and what the implication of that is. Okay, now we can go and run. So I can run this. And I get to choose what I want to run. Notice there's two items on the list, pizza GUI and unit test. Why do you suppose those are the two things there? Those aren't my only two classes. Yes?
Because those two have the main method.
Right, so that means that those two are the ones that you could run. Well, I want to run the pizza GUI, so I'll pick that. And lo and behold, here we go, and we can go and run it. So we can run it there. Avoid the messy command line stuff. I know you guys enjoyed it so much, but again, a GUI like this or an IDE like this will allow you to do that. And we can go in, and everything ought to work like it did before, and so on. And sure enough, it does. Okay, so that's how you can run it. One nice thing about this is this offers the facility to do debugging. That's one big benefit of using an IDE over the way that we've developed it. The way we've developed it is, if you've had a problem with your code, really my suggestion would be to put prints inside your code to sort of see where it was getting and where it wasn't getting, what were the values of some variables and so on. But this has the ability to go and put a breakpoint in your code. So notice I click on Java, the Pizza Java class. I can click on the, for example, calculate cost method. And that will open up in my window. All right. And I can set a breakpoint. So I set a breakpoint there. This is just like the debugging within Visual Studio. If I go and run this, or rather I say debug, I can go and then follow through the code as it's executing. So if I type in and I create my order and I pick small, thick crust, when I click add to order, one of the things it's going to do is it's going to calculate the cost of the pizza. So as I click that, not really showing it stopping in there. I'll have to review that to see why that is not behaving the way that I would expect it to. That's something I'll have to review. Because that is useful. If anyone finds out or has experience with that, feel free to let me know what it's doing. But again, with a breakpoint, normally what it does is it stops and it shows you what it is in executing that. Oh, wait a minute. I think I might know why it didn't. Did I make a sheet pizza? Yes, I did. So I'll make it not a sheet pizza. Click add to order. And now, this kind of launch is configured to open the debug perspective when it is, when it suspends. Do you want to open this perspective now? Yes, I do. So what this does is this shows us exactly where it is. And then we can step through the code one step at a time. So right now, we're at that code. And what we can do is size equals medium, all right, on our pizza. So we, when I hover my mouse over that variable, it shows me the value of it. That's a string variable, and size has a value of m. So I'm going to look. That should be false. So if I go in and say step into, actually, I should probably should have said step out. All right, or step over. It's now there, and I say step over. There I see it gets the cost equal to $10. So I can actually follow the path, the execution path. And again, if you've done this in Visual Studio with small changes, this is the same process. What's good about this is a very systematic way of testing the code. All right? I can then go and say continue, I'm sure somewhere. And I can disconnect the debugging or terminate the debugging. I think that terminated the application altogether. All right. So let's see. How do I exit this view? Oh, probably when I close out of this. And now perspective Java. There we go. And we're back to that. Okay, a few other benefits that this will be like the IntelliSense. By the way, and we saw some of the things that you can do with the breakpoint properties. You can make it so that it only goes suspend when the condition is true or not. So you don't always, you can set a sort of a condition on a breakpoint. I'm going to get rid of that breakpoint. If I type in something that is wrong, it should let me know. So if I say if size dot equals, it knows that size is nothing that is legal. All right? So if you make a typo, it will tell you that. On the other hand, if I type size dot equals, it will show me that that's correct. So you have the IntelliSense like you have in Visual Studio. Let's make a new class. All right. I can choose the name of the class. I can choose what package it goes into. Again, we're not going to worry about that right now. We're going to put everything into a package. We can pick the superclass that it belongs to, whether it's public or so on. All right. So let's make another kind of pizza. What would be another kind of pizza? Personal pizza. All right. And I can have as a superclass of that pizza. I can add any interfaces that it implements. I can add a public static void method to it. I can add the constructors from superclass. Remember, one thing that we did often is since constructors are not inherited in Java, a lot of times whenever we created a subclass, we duplicated the constructors in the subclass and just chained those up to the superclass's constructors. Or I can go and create constructors from superclasses. So I can go and then do that and click Finish. So now I've created my personal pizza. And if you notice, it generated those constructors for you. So you could just go in and fill the details in for those. And in fact, it took its best guess at what it thinks the constructor should be. That is, it changed it up to the super. Now, one thing that's cool, if you go and make some properties, string topping equals new string. Boolean let's say you can get mushrooms on a personal pizza. Under one of these guys here, you can generate all your getters and setters. All right. Also generate your hash code and your equal function. So I just defined a couple of properties. If I say generate getters and setters, it will go and it will allow me to pick, look at those properties, and say which ones I want to generate them for. And then I can go and generate that. So it has, again, a basic get method and set method for those new properties that I added to it. Again, that's the whole idea of this, is it saves you a lot of time. The reason I don't use it initially in the class is because I think it's good for you to learn it sort of from the bottom up and to learn on the nuts and bolts level. And then you'll see the benefit and see how you can use something like this effectively and take advantage of it. Questions about this so far? This is one of those things it's best to just to go and play around with. I have you do one of your labs. I want you to generate a jar, and I want you to generate Java docs for it. What are Java docs? We've seen Java docs anytime we've done and looked at a class definition. Java docs are sort of a standard format for Java documentation. If I look for the Java doc for string, for example, this is what I get. All right, it's part of the package Java lang. It's a class called string. It inherits from Java lang object. And then there's some more documentation. It includes field summary, the summary of constructors, the summary of methods that it inherits from Java lang object, and so on. So the nice thing about Java is once you get used to reading this sort of documentation, you can quickly generate your own Java documentation for your own applications. So how do you do that? I go up to File, Export. I have a choice of what I want to export. I'm going to say I want to export Java doc, all right? And I can go Finish. It will ask me, what do I want to generate it for? I'm going to generate for everything in source. And it can show you where you can put it. So I click finish. Okay, it'll save those. Yes. And then if I go out and look, it's writing to my workspace folder, my Java docs. And I can view that here within Eclipse. Or this is something you could put on your intranet or intranet site. So if I go to I go into my users folder, LCC lab. Here's my Eclipse workspace. Here's the files for pizza. Here's the files for doc. And I have all the HTML for the Java docs. So I could take this folder and publish that to my website. And then people could go and browse the different classes and things such as that. Looks just like we did in the other example. So we can look at the package, the class, the constructors that are available, and the constructor details and any methods that it has, along with what they return, what the methods return, and what the arguments are. By putting comments in some format, and I'm not sure exactly how to do that, you can actually generate commas and comments in your Java docs too. That's something that I'm not 100% sure. But I do want you to go, and for the application that you do, I want you to generate the Java docs. All right? The other thing, as I mentioned before, that you can do is you can generate a jar. If you had a bunch of classes, let's say, and it was not a full application, you could go up under export. Oops, edit, or file, export, and you could say I want to execute a jar file. Then people wouldn't need your source code, all right? They would just need the jar file, and they could include your jar file and use the classes that you've defined. So again, a lot of the things that we talk about, in class are smaller sort of projects where like one person's working on it and it really isn't a sense of sharing code. But when you get into larger projects, each team may be responsible for a subsystem or a certain aspect of it. And then there might be someone who puts together applications, writing some code and using classes from all over the place. Well, you could create a jar for the person that's going to be using and accumulating all the stuff together. The other thing that you could do is you could generate a runnable jar. All right? And what that's going to be is that's a runnable jar. It's going to be a jar that all you have to do is click on it, and you can run it. All right? So I'm going to say that I want a runnable jar. Where do I want to put it? And I'm going to put it on the, actually, let me check. Yeah, I'm not pointing at the right thing. One thing I've noticed about this, most IDEs, you have to be pointing at the right thing. So I want to generate a jar for this. So I have to be pointing at that. Runnable jar. Launch configuration. Again, I want to run Pizza GUI. Where do I want to put it? I can put it anywhere. I can put it on the desktop if I want. Or I can put it somewhere within that. I'm going to save it as pizza.jar. And list of other things that we can do. If I go and click that to run it, jar export finished without warning, see details for additional information. Tells me I have a couple warnings. But now I have an executable jar on my desktop. So if I double click it, it will fire up my application. So that could be given to people to run instead of giving them all your source. You know, giving people your source code is very dangerous, right? But when you're done, you want to be able to distribute to people. So giving them a runnable jar would be one way you could distribute your application to people. The other thing that you have is you have the ability to go in and export installed software items to file. Let's see what that does. Okay, never mind. We'll just leave it as executing a jar. So this sort of is killing two birds with one stone, because I did want to get you into the chance to play around with the jar. You're welcome to use Eclipse for any of your assignments for the rest of the semester. There is one assignment that you're required to use it in. But if you want to start using it for one of the ones that that you have not yet completed, feel free to do that. Should be installed upstairs in the lab. I think I did test it, not thoroughly, but I did see that it was installed up there. So I want to review that, but I also want to review deployment. And deployment is important because it relates to how you get the application in the person's hands. All right? What do you suppose the advantages and disadvantages of giving someone a jar that contains your code? What are some of the advantages and disadvantages of that? It's kind of hard to answer that until you know some of the other alternatives, right? So let's talk about some of the other alternatives. What are other ways that you can get Java code into the hands of your users? All right? This is pretty much the traditional old school: develop an application, people install the application on their machine, and then they can run it on their machine. The advantage of that is that they have the application, they have a copy of the application on their machine. Therefore, they do not need, for example, the internet to be up for them to run it, all right? Because it's right there. What do you suppose the disadvantage of that is, though? Disadvantage of that is, go ahead. Yeah, that some care needs to be taken to update the application, right? Because if there's a bug in that file, if there's a bug in the pizza application that we just created the jar for right now, and I gave it to 50 people, 50 people have that bug. There's 50 copies of that jar that has that bug. So I correct it. But the bug isn't really correct until all 50 people have that correction, right? And depending on the particular application you're dealing with, getting 50 people to update their computers with a new application can be a big deal, right? Now, again, I'm thinking in terms of like internal, if you're working as a software developer inside an organization. But it gets bigger when you start talking about like publicly distributed software, something that would go out to a bunch of people, you know. So I'm thinking about an old application I wrote for when I worked for Rockwell Automation, that was a field service engineer application where they could look and enter their work orders and do that. We didn't use Java for that, but we did the equivalent of this, where we created an install for everyone to install it on their machine. This is way back in like 2000, so it was a long time ago. All right. The problem with that is the field service engineers traveled literally around the world. And at the time in 2000, all right, they could be anywhere in the world where there may or may not have been dodgy internet. So to download an updated version of the application to get the latest bug fixes was a problem. They may only visit their home office once or twice a month. So if you send a CD with it on in the old days, all right? Now, things are a lot different than in the old days, all right? But still, the idea of if you give someone a copy of the executable code to run on their machine, The problem that you run into is every copy of that is going to contain all the bugs that exist in the executable code. And the bug isn't truly fixed until everyone has an update of that. So your organization may deal with that bug until everyone is updated with that. So, but that's a good option because you don't have to be connected to the internet. These field service engineers that were doing their work on these machines in a factory way out in a place that where internet connection wasn't really possible could enter all their data in because they had the application right there in front of them running, all right? Because they had a copy of it. But the problem is, again, deployment, getting updates. How do we solve that? How do we solve the problem of everyone having a copy of their own code? Yes? Okay. There's a couple of different ways. One is to make put it out there one place that they could get access to. There's actually a couple different ways that you could do that. One of them is with our friend, I think it's our friend, server-side scripting. All right. Some of you may be taking now CISS 243, all right, or have taken it in the past or will take it in the future. All right. That is an ASP.NET class. Well, we talk specifically about Microsoft's ASP.NET technology, but the concept is the same with Java coding. All right. I'm sort of presenting the overview of these things, and we'll talk in more detail about these things in future classes. I just want to sort of present you some of the deployment options so we can look at their respective advantages and disadvantages. Then we can look at specific examples of these. So you have a client connected to the internet accessing a web server. The client makes requests. The server responds. How does the server respond? By giving HTML files that contain HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. JavaScript, which is not Java, by the way. Important thing to make that distinction. Now, where does Java come into the play here? Java could be what these server-side scripts are written in. It's kind of hard to tell unless you know more details about the organization. But what are these server-side scripts? These are things that make websites and web pages dynamic. So, for example, you go in to log in to Canvas. You see your courses. What's more, you see permissions based on the fact that you're a student. So you can't go in and grade your own assignments. All right? You could go in and upload an assignment, but you can't go in and grade an assignment. You can upload that you've completed the assignment, so you have the permissions of a student. Is there a separate web page for each one of you? Of course not. That would be ridiculous to have a separate page for every student in every class. Instead, there's a program called the server-side script. And the web server has certain code that allows the web server to process this code, interact with the database, and come up with a custom page for everyone that logs in. Now, that's true regardless of the server-side language that we use. But we can do a couple of things that are related to Java. Again, Java, not JavaScript. One of them is to use what are called JSP files. The other is to use Java servlets. All right? We'll talk a little bit more about these on Wednesday. But essentially what they are both of these, are server-side code, stuff that runs on the server, that's a mix of Java code and HTML. So when someone requests a list of their classes, there's Java code that goes out there and reads the database and does its thing and produces an HTML file that gets sent to the user. All right? And that's a way that you can deploy applications via the web. So that's another way. In other words, you wouldn't write a conventional application. You would create a website that was a web application that was written in Java. So that's the second way you can get your Java code into the hands of the people that you want to get it to. Third way is something called Java Web Start. And that is pretty much what you had talked about. You're going to have a web page, and everything has to be configured, and the permissions have to be there, and so on. But you're going to have a web page where you click on a link, let's say. Then instead of a link to an HTML page, it's going to be the link to a Java program. When you click that link, boom, up is going to pop up a Java application. It's going to download the necessary jar and run that Java code on your machine. So in other words, every time you click on that link, you're getting a fresh copy of the Java code. In fact, in both these scenarios, the Java code only needs to be correct on the server, right? Because every time a customer goes to that and requests it, they're getting a new copy if a new copy is needed. All right, the pages are created on the fly dynamically, or in this case, the jar is downloaded. All right. A third way, I suppose, that you can get your Java code in the hands of people is via an Android application, right? Android uses Java as its programming language. So another way of deployment is to create an Android application which uses Java, and then you use the Play Store for a way of distributing that. Now, the good thing is that that handles some of the updating for you. You can have things set to automatically update and so on. Now, which technique you're going to take, you're going to consider all the factors about your application, all right? But if you're a Java programming house, let's say, and you're committed to using Java, and that's your language of choice within your organization, you do have a variety of ways you could possibly deploy your application into the hands of the people that need it. We'll start looking at some of these in a little more detail in class next time. All right, we'll see you up in lab.